Can we all stand for the procession for all the saints?
Oh, It doesn't say it in the program, but my job is to be the greeter of the greeters. It's kind of like in a wedding where you want to include a lot of your family, and you're handing out jobs like the ring bearer's attendance assistant. But it is my privilege to present to you those who will be bringing greetings to you, dignitaries and honored guests. And also to take a moment to say, look around at one another and give one another your attention and take in this moment. An installation service is in some ways like a wedding where all sorts of people come together, all of us connected in some way through the institution or through Steve Ray, but many of us new to each other. And like a wedding, there is a reception to follow, a beautiful moment where the president of the seminary throws out a bouquet, and the first one to catch it will get the next PhD in systematic theology. To the dignitaries, we say, we all know Steve in different ways, now as President Ray. But for those of you who knew him as family members, some of you knew him as a baby in teddy bear pajamas, little kid glasses, and a tiny silk bow tie. Others of you know him through teaching academic institutions. Some of you have gone to school with Steve, and that is where Steve and I met in Yale Divinity School all those years ago as we got our Master of Divinity. And Steve was already a grown-up, and I was a child genius admitted at the age of 4. As we greet one another, let us give thanks to God for bringing all of us together. For every one of us is a distinguished guest, and all of us now are connected by being here today, connected by the Holy Spirit who gives us life. Amen.
To Pastor Moss, Chairman Clark, President Ray, this is Susan Ray, Kiara, to all the warriors and witnesses gathered in this place. A few weeks ago, I was in Kingston, Jamaica, and I visited the home of that great musician, Rastafarian, and theologian, Bob Marley. This is what Bob Marley says. As people would appropriate my music, I would get inspired and change my music. The more that people listened to my ska, the more I would get inspired to change. And so we've come this afternoon to embrace change. Change not out of pain, but change out of process and progress. We've come to honor a change agent, the Reverend Dr. Stephen G. Ray, Jr. We've come to honor you, our change collaborators. And yes, we are ever mindful of those change forerunners, our foreparents, who in many ways tap us on the shoulder to encourage us to run and see what the end will be. Bob Marley last resided at a place called 56 Hope Road. And so this afternoon we are gathered because of hope. Hope, yes, because of what has happened. Hope because of things could be better. And hope because of what is indeed on the horizon. We have hope in the one who holds us in the hollow of divine hands. And so on behalf of the esteemed Board of Trustees, the very fine faculty, our marvelous staff, and our feet to the fire students, we are just rapturous about sharing this moment with you. For indeed, change has come, and in the words of another great theologian, a change is going to come. Thank you.
To the members of the Board of Trustees, distinguished guests and dignitaries from the church and theological education, to the Chicago Theological Seminary faculty, administrators, students, alums, and members of the board, to Dr. Moss and those of you from Trinity United Church of Christ, and to you, Dr. Stephen Ray, the 13th president of Chicago Theological Seminary. As a former president at McCormick Theological Seminary and current executive director of the Association of Theological Schools, I bring greetings on behalf of ATS, a member organization with 279 schools that span the theological and ecclesial spectrum, Roman Catholic, Orthodox, mainline Protestant, and evangelical Protestant, all working together in ecumenical cooperation to promote the enhancement and improvement of theological education to the benefit of communities of faith and the broader public. On this year, where ATS celebrated its 100-year anniversary as an organization, it is both a professional and personal privilege to extend commendation to Chicago Theological Seminary for its transformative choice in president, and to offer to my good friend, Dr. Stephen Ray, my heartiest congratulations. It is hard to think of a better match between visionary justice-seeking school and a president whose leadership will extend CTS's legacy and propel it into a bold future. I still remember having conversations over coffee when Dr. Ray and I were aspiring faculty, both who felt called to eventually lead seminaries into futures that their founders did not see. President Ray, you are the right person called to the right place for such a time as this. When God calls, leaders rise. When there are few prophets in the land, God raises them up. When a nation divides, leaders show up with the capacity to inspire a third way. For as the Lord declares, I'm about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So to you, Dr. Ray, and to Chicago Theological Seminary, congratulations on this call of calls, and welcome to this service within the Association of Theological Schools. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and may the Lord's face shine upon you now, in good times and in those times when challenges arise. Blessings on you and all who call upon the name of God within God's beloved community. Thanks be to God.
Dr. Ray has been a participant and leader in Wabash Center programming since 1999. His vision of the life of the teacher scholar has influenced over 100 faculty through our common work. Whether leading a workshop, directing a grant, serving as a consultant, or mentoring faculty, Dr. Ray demonstrates a keen intellect, a generous spirit, and unmatched courage. He will bring these gifts and more to CTS. Blessings from Wabash Center on the journey.
To President Ray and his family, to the Board of Trustees, faculty and staff, students and alumni of the Columbia Theological Seminary community. I bring you warm greetings from Atlanta, Georgia, and a warm welcome from the Forum for Theological Exploration, also known as FTE. My name is Stephen Lewis, and what I would like to say is that the ties that really between this seminary, Dr. Ray and myself, are historic and they are significant. 45 years ago, approximately 45 years ago, CTS hired its first African-American president in the person of the late Charles Shelby Rooks. Before Rooks took his position as CTS president, he was the executive director of FTE, and he founded two important initiatives that overlap with Steve, Dr. Ray, and my tenure. The first one being the Doc the FTE Black Doctoral Fellowship Program, and the second one being the Society for the Study of Black Religion. And those two programs were founded in the turbulent times of the 60s, and now, 50 years later, we celebrate 50 years of celebrations of that doctoral program. And next year, we will celebrate 50 years of the Society for the Study of Black Religion, where Stephen Ray also serves as president, but also has the honor of stewarding Reverend Rook's legacy of cultivating and nurturing a Black theological and intellectual tradition. It's in this spirit and in this vein that when I look at the state of this country and even the field of theological education, we need leaders like Dr. Ray, who will write and communicate from a long tradition, who stands on the shoulders of daughters and sons of Africa descent, to bring about a theological tradition and an intellectual, a Black intellectual tradition that can speak to the hearts of the matters of our communities and in our country. So my colleagues and I look forward to working with Dr. Ray under his new tenured leadership. Congratulations to him in this prestigious inauguration. And God blessing upon Dr. Ray, this community, and also the institutional vocation that will continue to grow under his leadership.
To Dr. Ray, his family, CTS Board of Trustees, students, faculty, my dear beloved brother, Reverend Moss, and my family at Trinity. Assalamu alaikum, peace and blessings be upon you all. It is an extraordinary honor to be asked to be here to witness this extraordinary occasion. And I start by reflecting on where I was this last Christmas morning. On December 25th, found myself unexpectedly in Bethlehem, walking into the Church of Nativity for the first time, experiencing what it felt like to walk into the world's oldest living, breathing church, to hear the majestic voices of the choir that was gathered for that morning service, and to take it in as a Muslim American living on the south side of Chicago, whose mother was not born far from that very church over 70 years ago, and then left as a refugee to the south side of Chicago. And while I stood there absorbing that moment, I was moved with several others to then leave the comfort of that beautiful church a mile or two away to a refugee camp, where we saw mothers desperately sweeping away the canisters of tear gas that was shelled upon them the night before, where I saw a young boy and his father tearing apart the metal from rubber bullets, hammering it into reusable material and making jewelry to sell to the visitors, where I saw generations of refugees reminding me to remind my brothers and sisters across the globe that their plight is still one to be prayed for and thought of here. And I thought about where I was that morning and what morning it was and whose birth we were commemorating, and somehow, some way, I felt that as beautiful as that church was, as beautiful as the choir was, that first century Palestinian Jew, rebel, rabbi, convicted seditionist, Jesus of Nazareth, would probably be in a refugee camp more likely than being sitting in the church that day. And I thought about the spirit of that Jesus, the Jesus who stood with the dispossessed, the wretched of the earth. And I couldn't help but be grateful for the institutions that have inspired me with that spirit of Jesus. And there is probably no other greater institution in this city and even in this country than that of the Chicago Theological Seminary, who probably would have not only expected but mandated its graduate students, if to visit Bethlehem on Christmas morning, to not get too comfortable in the church and to quickly move to the refugee camp, that was the lessons of Jesus that we should reflect and learn upon. And as I read and learn and watch and witness in great anticipation the leadership of Dr. Ray, I know that we have in our leader a person who will bring this institution into the next phase of its leadership to reclaim and recover that spirit at a time and a place in a city and country that needs it more than ever. And for that, Dr. Ray, please know that those of us who are working in the pains of a segregated city, who are still dealing with inequity on all levels, will be praying for you that the Most High continue to rain upon you blessings, mercy, and the extraordinary love and compassion that you will lead this institution along with all of us to a greater day. Thank you.
To Dr. Ray and your beloved family, to Chicago Theological Seminary faculty, students, and friends, to all other honored guests. I offer greetings on behalf of the 5,000 churches and almost a million members of the United Church of Christ, on behalf of my fellow officers, Tracy Blackman and Jim Mose, on behalf of one of my predecessors, dear friends and mentors, John Thomas, here with us today, on behalf of two of your colleagues, also here, David Greenhaw and Lou Zeidner from Eden Theological Seminary and United Theological Seminary, and on behalf of Char Birch, Bertie Powers, and Jim Olson, members of the Illinois Conference staff here with us today. I feel like a proud sister standing before an audience and bragging about something that her sibling has done that brings honor to the entire family and household. The United Church of Christ has always, as a body, sought to bring a just world for all, sought to live out of the gospel proclamation of extravagant welcome and radical love. And Chicago Theological Seminary has continuously produced clergy fully prepared to engage the world in just that way. And as we are about to sing together in a beautiful hymn, the United Church of Christ to Chicago Theological Seminary says we need you to survive. And because of the difference that you make in the lives of those who are called into service on behalf of this gospel of radical love, because of that, we today stand proud because you have called one who has the capacity to continue your history, to continue your legacy, to continue your tradition of preparing these souls for the ministry into which they will give themselves for the rest of their lives. We need you to survive, and of you we are proud because of what you have done and who you have called to serve you in this moment.
Shalom, good afternoon. Before I begin, I want to apologize at the outset. The Sabbath Shabbat comes in at 6:01, and I have an hour and a half drive back, so I'm going to leave a little bit early. I am honored and thrilled to be here to bring greetings on behalf of the Jewish Federation of Metropolitan Chicago. I have been here before. On June the 2nd, 2009, I had the sheer delight to be here at another installation. Reverend Otis Moss III was installed at Trinity United by his venerable and magisterial father, Reverend Otis Moss Jr. of Cleveland, who was co-pastor with the Reverend Martin Luther King, may the memory of the righteous be for a blessing. And when he installed his son, he turned to the book of Joshua, and the father spoke to the son as God spoke to Joshua, be strong and courageous. He said to him, as Moses spoke to Joshua, the father spoke to the son, as God was with Moses, so God will be with you. Those are pretty good words for someone being installed, and I could stop there, but I'm not going to. And the reason is, I'm not the member of the same faith community as my beloved friend, Reverend Ray. I'm not a member of a Christian seminary administration or faculty, but I have a connection to Reverend Ray that nobody else, I think, in this room has. And it's only a year and a half old. President Lelaine Rector of Garrett Evangelical Theological Seminary said to me a year and a half ago, female presidents of Christian seminaries have very great power. So I listened. And she said to me, you have to go talk to Dr. Ray. I said, why? She said, he studies the Holocaust. You have to go talk with him. All right. I went and I talked with him. I sat down in his office and I said, Dr. Ray, why are you studying the destruction of European Jewry? And then I sat and listened. And not only that, I brought others back to listen. And he taught me as follows. And the Holocaust is not something about which I am ignorant, and I was stunned. He said, I have to prepare people for the ministry. To prepare people for the ministry today is to prepare them to deal with racism. And therefore, I wanted to understand and study this greatest evil, the systematic destruction of 6 million Jews. I said, what did you learn? And he gave me two phrases. Hardly a day goes by when I don't use them since then. He said, I learned about the locality of morality. The locality of morality. I said, what does that mean? He said, there is too much focus on the national policy of the Germans and not enough focus on the fact that in a small town or a little village in Germany, the baker and the dentist and the grocer and the minister would get up for a few weeks and go to Poland like we have an Illinois National Guard, murder a few thousand Jews, and then come home. There was a village in Poland where Jews were murdered, and right next door to it was a village in Poland where Jews were saved. I said, okay, take me to the next step. You go to the lynching map, he said, which you can find on the New York Times website of the South. And you can see in one county in Mississippi a lot of lynchings, and in a county right next door, no lynchings. Now, we may not know why, but locality is morality. In one town in Germany, evil was afoot. In one town in Poland, righteousness was afoot. And in a county in Mississippi, some people didn't do what other people did in another county in Mississippi. I was absolutely stunned by that lesson. Indeed, locality is morality. Morality and all goodness live in the localities of our cities, our neighborhoods, our streets, the places we live. CTS is now this new locality for Reverend Ray. It is here that he assumes his new spiritual responsibilities. He is now responsible for the spiritual formation of men and women who are charged with bringing those created in the image of God ever closer to our common Creator in heaven and to ever greater service to all those created in the image of God. The Reverend Ray is a spiritual leader destined to manifest that not only is locality morality, Locality is goodness. Locality is sweetness. Locality is wisdom. Locality is righteousness. Locality is compassion. For Reverend Ray, this locality is the capacity to bring others to live their lives in awe of the Creator. Chicago Theological Seminary is now the locality to which you have brought him. In this locality, he will prosper. You, his colleagues, friends, and students will prosper by his light. Reverend Ray, this is your locality. And because of you, this locality is not just morality, it is sanctity and radiance. Reverend Ray, my teacher, God bless you and your family on this marvelous day.
Thank you to all our distinguished speakers and guests, those who have spoken, those who have yet to speak, those of you who have come all this way. And lastly, we thank the mighty cloud of witnesses who gather with us, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, a world without end. Amen. Amen.
Can we all just stand, and we're going to look at the congregational hymn in your book. And you're not just going to stand around and sing to yourself. You're going to sing to the people that are next to you. Because this song talks about everything you just heard. It says, I need you to survive. I need you to thrive. So just work on it and try to sing it to somebody. I need, tell them, you need, look at somebody, you stand with me, agree with me. Come on, say it. We're all. It is His will that every. Now look at somebody in the eye if you can and say, you are important. Somebody just need to see it. You are important to me. All right. Yep. Now y'all done sung it once, now you got used to it. Now find somebody else. Go out your way. I need you. Tell them. We're all aboard. Stand with me. Agree with me. We're all aboard. It is His will that every knee. Come on, look at him and tell him. You are important. I need you to. Come on, you are important. Now this is the part you just stood next to these people for the last 45 minutes. Let's go. You're gonna say, I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you and I need you. Tell them I won't harm you with any kind of word. I love you. Come on, let's go. Take it up. Y'all can sing it better. You pray for me. Tell them I love you. I won't harm you with words. Come on, let's get it really good. Come on, take it up. You pray for me. And I need you. Book no more. Just put the book down. Say, I pray. You pray. I love you. And I need you to survive. I won't fall. It is His will. Say it. Now just turn to somebody. Some of y'all scared to look at each other. Come on. You are. Look at him and tell him. around him if you want to hug him. Say, you are. You don't know what somebody needs. Just to need a touch. I need you to. Now grab that person by the hand. Last one. You are. And raise that hand up as a sign of, I need you to survive. Now give God the kind of praise that he deserves, because you've got some friends.
I will bless the Lord at all times, and God's praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together. We will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the people. We will sing praises to you among the nations. For your steadfast love is as high as the heavens. Your faithfulness extends to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above the earth. Let your glory fall on this place. Let your glory fill this place. Let your glory fill our hearts. Right now, Lord, we surrender unto you, to your will and your way. Have your way in this worship. Oh, Lord, we pray.
Let us pray. Eternal God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast and our eternal home. God, we need you. We thank you, and we are here because you are. Have your way in this place. May what we do and say and think in this space be pleasing to you. In the words of our ancestors, come on in the room. Break us, melt us, mold us after your will. And for this, we will be careful always to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. We ask it all in the matchless name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, with thanksgiving. Amen.
My name is Amy Plantinga-Powell. My dear friend Serene Jones is unfortunately ill and unable to be here. So with President Ray's blessing, she has passed the torch to me and given me the honor and privilege to present to you the Reverend Dr. Stephen G. Ray, Jr. This is a proud and joyful day. I have been watching Stephen's rise as a theologian and public intellectual for almost 20 years now, sometimes from afar and sometimes up close. I was on the search committee at Louisville Presbyterian Seminary that called President Ray to his first full-time faculty position. Stephen and I were theology colleagues, and while I like to think that as his senior colleague, I had a hand in shaping the wise and accomplished scholar that he is today, the truth is that he taught me a lot too. In addition to being a consummate scholar and teacher, President Ray has the heart and soul of a pastor. He is a person of great courage and great moral integrity. He is a loving husband to Susan, a proud father to Kiara. This is a proud day, a joyful day, but it is not a surprising day. When I hear of some theologians who have become deans or presidents, my first reaction is, huh, that's interesting. Who would have thought? But when it was announced that Dr. Ray had been appointed as the 13th president of Chicago Theological Seminary and professor of theology, my first reaction was, of course. Here is someone whose theological work sits at the intersection of race, culture, and politics. Here is someone who understands the tenaciousness of structural sin, but also knows that human flourishing is a social project, not an individual one. Here is someone who believes that progressive Christian theology has a role to play in that project, calling out injustice, creating what Reverend William Barber calls fusion coalitions of diverse people bonding together for the moral reconstruction of our society. Here is someone who understands theological doctrines as resources for analyzing our social problems, stepping into our questions, charting a new way forward. Here is someone who loves the church despite its failings. Here is someone who has been honing his leadership skills over the years in other academic institutions, in the American Academy of Religion, in the Work Group on Constructive Theology, and in the Society for the Study of Black Religion. President Ray has been preparing to take up this job for a long time, and now that joyful day has come. The late and beloved Katie Geneva Cannon liked to say that the role of a teacher is to set people free to live into the graces and gifts they've been given. President Ray has had a good many good teachers over the years, and he has been a good teacher himself. But I also see this presidency as a teacher, as a catalyst for setting him free to live into the graces and gifts he's been given. God bless you, President Ray, and God bless this institution.
That God is so awesome. Can y'all just wave your hand? Because he's deserving of all of our praise. Just say, God, thank you.
Bye.
Amen means I agree. Amen. So we release the blessing on President Ray. May the CTS Seminary begin to prosper. May God do something new in this place.
Good afternoon, everyone. I will be reading from Matthew chapter 11, verses 2 through 5. When John heard in prison what Jesus was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we waiting for another?" Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you heard and see. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised, and the poor have gotten the good news brought to them." Amen.
Good afternoon. I'll be reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 18 through 20. And Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of the sight to the blind, and let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Amen.
Hello. I will be reading from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, "Truly, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy. But the Lord said to me, 'Do not say, I am only a boy, for you shall go to all whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you,' says the Lord. Then the Lord put his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, 'Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant.'"
So I only wish that my seminary experience had such exciting worship. Amen. Can we just celebrate this choir and all that they are bringing to us this day? We give honor to God, to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to the Spirit of God that is present with us in this place, to President Stephen G. Ray, Jr. Amen. Can we celebrate the president one more time? Is that all right? Amen. To Sister Susan Ray and Kiara, blessings to you both. To the chair of the trustees, Brian Clark, and immediate past chair, Norman Williams. To Dean Buckhannon Crowder. To the Reverend Dr. Otis Moss III, pastor of the Trinity Church. To faculty, students, and friends. I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge one of my former professors that's in the house, Dr. Valerie Bridgman as well. Amen. Good to see you in the house. I am excited to be here with you today. I would, for a moment, just want to reiterate part of the text that was read into your hearing from the book of Jeremiah. And it says in the 9th and the 10th verse, "Now I put my words in your mouth. See today, I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." Architects of a new America. Let's pray, family. Loving God, we give you thanks and praise for this moment in time that we are able to gather in this church and with this seminary to celebrate the installation of its new president, your son and servant, Stephen Ray. We pray, O God, that you would now come and thunder in the ears of your people. Speak truth and life to each and every one of us. God, go to that deep place that we hide from everybody else, and that you would permeate by the power of your Spirit and shake us and rattle us at the places that we find ourselves at this moment in time. Now, God, I pray that you would remove everything out of me that's not like you. Fill me with your Spirit. Cover me in the blood of the Lamb, that every spot, wrinkle, or blemish is cast away. And then, Lord God, I pray for everyone under the sound of my voice, that every deaf ear be made to hear, blind eye made to see, stony heart become that of flesh, every mind that's resistant to the gospel would submit itself this day, and every tongue that refused to give you praise would be loosed to shout hallelujah. Have your way, God, in this time and in this place and with us, your people. This, God, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 I know some of you are saying, who is this guy? And so I wanted to share a little bit of, I've been reflecting since Dr. Ray asked me to come and share with you. I'm not in the academy. I don't have a PhD, let alone a D-min or anything of the sort. I'm just a kid from Philly that loves the Lord and believes that God has given us enough power to change the damn world. I was around 18, 19 years old when I met Dr. Ray for the very first time. He was the Northeast Regional Director for Iota Phi Theta, and I was a new pledgee from Boston College. Perhaps one of the, amen, there's some Iotas in the house, praise the Lord, amen, ow, ow. I remember meeting Susan and Kiara for the first time when I was at their apartment in Hartford. And Kiara was actually in a wheel, she was in a high chair, and they were feeding her. And I was sitting there having a conversation with Steve and Susan, and I was reflecting back on the fact that that would be sort of a constant experience in my life for years to come. Sitting at their kitchen, when they moved to Philadelphia, I would be sitting in their kitchen and we would have time together. I would be found in Steve's office at Lutheran Theological Seminary. As I reflected, who knew back then what was going to happen and that we would be both here now. Throughout the years after that time in Boston and when Steve was in Hartford, we had some limited contact. But when Dr. Ray came to Lutheran Theological Seminary in Philadelphia, I received an email which said, "It's time for you to finish that which you started," which was going back to the fact that I had started my degree at Eastern Baptist Theological Seminary, but I was being told by my big brother it was time to finish the work that I had begun. And so I went over to Lutheran Theological Seminary and eventually finished my degree over there. But during that time, Dr. Ray became to me not just my fraternity brother, but he was my advisor, my professor, my friend, my mentor. And at one point, he also became a parishioner as he became a member of the congregation that I was leading in Philadelphia until he was lured away from Philly to Chicago to be at Garrett Evangelical Seminary. Our relationship has grown and shifted over the years as Dr. Ray became a trusted thought partner in the work for justice. Part of the work that I do is helping to lead a national organization called Faith in Action, the nation's largest faith-based organizing movement, not just here in the U.S., but becoming international in more and more countries where we believe in the power of the people, the power of God at work with the people to be able to transform their circumstances and their situations, to be able to have a say in their collective destiny. And in the work that I do every single day, we have deep theological reflection. And there were moments when I would get stuck on something that I would pick up the phone, ask Dr. Ray some obscure question, and just sit there and listen. And I don't know if any of you have ever done that before, but you just ask him a question and then you just prepare to take notes. I remember in seminary when Dr. Ray would come into a class, we had a Saturday morning systematics one class, and he would walk into the class, everybody else is still groggy-eyed, he'd show up dressed to the T's with his bow tie on point, and he would come in, no books, no briefcase, no anything, sit down and begin to lecture direct for 3 hours straight, and would tell us where to find such and such in the book on such and such a page, and would be able to go there, argue and refute every point every person would bring up in the class. At the end of class, he would get up, walk out the door, and everybody would wonder what just happened. And so, when the work gets deep, we would often, in Faith in Action, call Dr. Ray and ask him deep questions. Back a few years ago, we invited him to Philadelphia. We were doing a symposium, a conference around the economy. And he walked in, we were at Mother Bethel AME Church, the mother church of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, and for those of us from Philly, a dear, dear institution of black empowerment. And we specifically chose to have this conversation about economics in Mother Bethel. And Dr. Ray walks in and is the keynote speaker for the event and dropped this bomb on us that continues to reverberate years later inside the work that we do. He said, "The American economy is not built off the backs of people of color." He said, "The American economy is built off the misery of dark-skinned bodies in this country." That just sat with us. And not just for that day, but even now, periodically when we're doing work around mass incarceration, when we're trying to find ways to support undocumented immigrants, when we're fighting the battle to raise the minimum wage for low-wage workers, many of whom are people of color, mostly women of color who are single mothers, we are reminded that the country that we live in makes its profit and it pimps out the bodies and the misery of dark-skinned people. And so many of us follow Dr. Ray on social media, and because he's prolific and challenging, always waiting for that nugget that's going to come out even on social media that will be transformative to the work that we were doing, that we are doing to create and change the world, create a new society. Dr. Ray has spent a lot of time in recent days talking about building a new society, creating a new environment, creating a world that is different than what it is right now. And when he and I were talking as we were preparing for this, he started talking about this. And I can't say that I'm a really great original theologian. I have to lean on other folk. But as he was talking about the new society, I was reminded of this text in Jeremiah. Jeremiah's call story that wasn't just about Jeremiah's call, but it was about something far more profound and something far deeper than just calling a prophet. I mean, after all, every single one of us in here has got a call story, and we could go on ad infinitum about our call story. But there's a reason that Dr. Stephen Ray has been called at a time like this to come to Chicago Theological Seminary. There's a reason that he has been called into leadership, not 5 years ago, not 10 years ago, but at this time in human history. We need a Dr. Stephen Ray because he's got some work he's got to do to help us get things right. If I were to be honest with you, part of the mess that we are in right now, not only in this country and in the world, is because the church has abandoned its responsibility. The church is to blame for a lot of the mess that we have going on right now. And rooted in the midst of all that mess is this notion of white male hegemony that has continued to perpetrate not only in the systems of secular society, but even the church. I know y'all gonna get quiet on me now as I talk about this. But the reality is that a society that is built upon an idol and an idolatry, this notion of white men as being the most superior force and therefore in the image of God, has worked itself into a place that has created significant division in the world. The reality is, until we can see God as a disabled person, God as a woman of color, God as a lesbian, and God as a trans person, until we are able to see God as an undocumented person, we cannot get the full image of God. And so the reality is that in the words, in the ministry of the academy, Dr. Ray, you've got to do some deconstruction in terms of some of the hundreds of years of theological education that we have that are leading us down the wrong path. In the Jeremiah, in the call that God gave to Jeremiah, he says to him, I put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over seminaries and over kingdoms to pluck up and to pull down. The church, the academy, like the church, is slow to change. In 2015, Pew put out a study that talked about all the folk that were walking away from the church. And the seminary and the church couldn't change fast enough to address the issue. Part of the issue was the inauthenticity of church, that we would come to great mausoleums called churches and have worship, but the people on the outside of the church were dying and feeling like they were living in hell every single day, and we did not have a word of hope for them. But I remember being a student at Lutheran Theological Seminary and hearing for the first time a professor critique the church. This professor was a brother from New York City who was reminding us that the call, the prophetic call, before it was sexy to say that we were being prophetic, he was reminding us that we had to be prophetic. He was reminding us that the work in the academy and the work in the church is to destroy those things that are keeping us separated and find ways to be drawn to one another, to be able to speak to the people that are in the deepest pain and help them to find hope, not only in Jesus, but also to find hope within themselves. We had to pluck up and pull down the weeds that were trying to choke us in our communities, that were trying to keep us from being able to find Jesus. It's difficult to find Jesus when the images all around you of your oppressor that's trying to keep you from living your full best life. And so sometimes we had to pluck up and we had to pull down those things that were around us. And then sometimes we just had to outright destroy them, to overthrow them, to cast them out. Sometimes we can't be the nice faith people. Sometimes we got to call it out for what it is and speak truth. Sometimes we have to speak truth even to our traditions that are not rooted in our faith, but are rooted in power structures trying to keep people in order. Yeah. That was Dr. Ray teaching all of us that we had to destroy and to overthrow and get rid of all the things that were tearing at us. I remember he gave a lecture one time and began to talk about the Christian roots of the Ku Klux Klan. He gave this deep lecture about all this. And when we walked away from the lecture, we were standing there in amazement at everything that he had just laid out. And for many of the students that were listening that day, we were thinking it's not just the Klan that believes this. It's the regular church that believes this as well. And we began deep on the inside, begin to wrestle. What is it that we have to take out of our church, take out of our theology, take out of our ritual, take out of the things that we do on a daily basis so that we could be really the church of God? We had to destroy and overthrow some stuff, even if the academy and church leadership would say that we were heretics for doing so. Sometimes being a heretic is better than being in the mix. Amen, somebody. But finally, there's a call to build and to plant. I am not one of those people that believes that faith is an addendum. And really, in many ways, in civil society, faith is an addendum. And too many of our clergy and leaders are happy to get invited to do a benediction and an invocation at an event and fail to speak truth when those events are really about tearing down our folk. The mayor calls, the governor calls, the president calls. We go show up. Amen, somebody. There was a group of them went to go see the president not too long ago. I'm not sure what they were doing. Some of them needed to come to Chicago Theological Seminary to get trained so they could really speak truth to power in that space. Amen. You don't have to say amen. That's all right. It's hard truth. Some of them need some training. But the reality is that we have got to get to a place where we are trying to create a new society. And I'm sorry, the Democrats and the Republicans, the Green Party, and every other political party can't do it. I hate to tell you, business will not do it. And the only place that we are going to be able to find hope for the future is when the church rises up, when the seminaries rise up, and we begin to train and teach our people that every human life has value. Every single person is worthy in the sight of God, that every voice must be listened to, every person respected. That when we get away from white dominated leadership and begin to bring the best of every culture, every race, every gender identity, every differently abled individual, every indigenous community, every African American community, every Latinx community, every Asian Pacific Islander community. When we all get together, when we got biracial folk all at the table, sitting at God's common table, wrestling together and trying to find a way that will build all of us up. Then, in that moment, we will create a new society. We will become architects of a new America. We will be the ones that will call to order all out of the chaos that is existing in this world right now. It will be the church, and maybe, just maybe, at a little seminary called Chicago Theological Seminary here in the city of Chicago, Illinois, under the leadership of President Stephen G. Ray Jr., maybe in this place, in this seminary called CTS, there will be a burgeoning awakening coming forth, that people will leave this place and not be content just to be inside the four walls of the church, but they will say that my ministry is to the church and to the community. The seminarians and the professors that come from this place will not see themselves as satisfied with tenure if people outside are dying, but they will get excited about being agents for justice and transformation. Where their books and their studies and their lectures will point to a new pathway, to a new nation, and to a new world. Dr. Ray, God called you 30 years ago, but you've got a new calling now. The world needs it because people have been dying, waiting for your ministry in this place, so you can shape the minds that will lead us into the future. God bless you. Amen.
Shine on.
President Ray, just yesterday, I met with Alton B. Pollard III, who is the president of Louisville Presbyterian Theological Seminary. And he asked me to bring you blessings and congratulations to you, to Susan and Kiara, on behalf of the Louisville Seminary community. I am so happy to bring those blessings. You need to know that I have the happy task of charging President Ray, and that happy task has haunted me since he asked me to do it, in part because Stephen and I go back 29 years, almost 30 years, when we were students together at Yale Divinity School. And in knowing him that long, what I wanted to raise and lift up and to charge him with is that which I love about him. And the challenge was how to do that in a way that also correlates to the world in which we live and inspires him to challenge the systems that he needs to challenge. So my charge draws deeply from the well of brotherhood. I believe that you and I, Stephen, have been around the block so many times, I don't know how many new tricks we can learn, so my charge will be steeped in what you already know and who you already are and what you have done exceedingly well. I want my charge to be so simple and clear that 20 years from now, President Ray and this audience will remember it. What we must do, Stephen, is to clarify and amplify what we have found to be true, to be good, to be beautiful, to be just in the years that we have been at work.
We must clarify and amplify, not for the generations who have gone before us, but for the generations to come, so that they might have a witness that inspires their moral imagination. And then we must jump into the great fights of the day. And one of the things that I admire most about you, President Ray, is that no matter where you have lived, no matter where you have worked, you have jumped into the great fights of the day. You have done that not in some kind of generic, idealistic, philosophical way. You have joined cause with people in the neighborhood, in the community, who were resisting oppression and injustice. And you have helped them to find and to cultivate their own voices. You have done, as my patron, Saint Frederick Douglass, once said, you have prayed with your heels as well as your heart. And that is one of the qualities that I love most about you, one of the traits that you have. It's also one base for my charge. My charge also draws deeply from the deep interwoven commitments of Chicago Theological Seminary. And one commitment in particular expresses the idea that in a world suffering from spiritual impoverishment, that we must proclaim a message of divine purpose, compassion, and promise. This too is something that President Ray has done in all the years that I have known him. My way of putting it, drawing from African-American witness over the years, is to say that President Ray has kept faith. That President Ray has navigated the frustrations, the difficulties, the setbacks, what he once said to me was the grown-up stuff of life, without losing his moral compass. He has suffered setback and loss. We've been there together. Anger, systems that wouldn't change, regret. But through it all, President Ray has kept faith. And now we need, in this chair, President Ray, to be able to create the resources, to pull them together necessary to help to inspire the moral imagination of people coming into theological education today. What does it look like to keep faith? Not in the 19th century abolition movement, not in the 20th century civil rights movement. What does it mean to keep faith today? And that is the second base for my charge. To be as simple and transparent as I can possibly be. I charge you, President Ray. I charge you to pray with your heels and to inspire all of the students who will come to this place while you are president to see new, innovative ways of praying with their heels, honoring the traditions that have been bequeathed to them, but yet finding their own moral voice and discerning how they might, in these difficult days, pray with their heels. I charge you, President Ray, to keep faith. I don't mean keep faith as if it is something that is passive. I mean keep faith as the meaning-making, justice-making practices of discipleship, what you have always done in the years that I have known you. I charge you to help all the students who will come to this place while you are president to imagine what it might mean in this day for them to keep faith.
more than this, and part of the challenge is to have integrity to manage to integrate praying with our heels and keeping faith. And that is the hard work of this challenge, to help students to find the integrity to integrate praying with their heels and keeping faith in ways that are woke, in ways that are true to the moment that they occupy during these difficult times. But there's one more thing, and the last part of my charge is this. I charge you, President Ray, to remember that all of these people you see here today are people who at a moment's notice will work with you, will inspire you, if need be, will get on a plane from Kentucky and fly here to be with you, that you have support in this work, and don't think for a second that this is something you must do alone. We are with you in the work that lies ahead. Remember, Stephen, pray with your heels and teach others how to do that. Keep faith and make sure the resources are here to cultivate that moral imagination in students who will come your way, and remember that you do this with us. Bless you, my brother.
I come to you again. Reverend Dr. Otis Moss has cared for his flock from this very pulpit week after week after week. And during the years I've been a trustee, I can tell you of his support and compassion for CTS. I can also tell you that he has shared with me, as has Dr. Rear shared with me, their friendship for each other. And so, sometimes you cannot be where you want to be. Sometimes you have to be where you must be. And so, Dr. Ray, I'm happy to step in and be helpful today. To the constituencies, I have a charge for you to keep. I have a calling for you to embrace. Members and guests of the CTS community, Professor Williamson has charged Dr. Ray. I now charge you, students, staff, faculty, trustees, ministerial colleagues, academic colleagues, judicatory and denominational leaders, even Stephen's beloved family and his friends. I have a charge for you to keep. I have a calling for you to embrace. First, trust Stephen and trust his judgment. We have chosen him to lead us, so let him lead. The path that Stephen chooses to walk may seem hard to us. He will see a destination that we will not. Change is disorienting. Let us embrace the challenges that are before us. If we've learned anything from our living, it is that our past cannot be our future. There is no turning around. We live on the journey. The journey is home. Stephen knows this. He is ready. He is ready with us to step out on faith. Trust him. Let him lead. Second, support him. Stephen sits in a lonely chair. He will make decisions that will be painful to himself and to others. He will take risks that frighten. And in the risk-taking, he will fight the fear within himself. There will be days that begin with stress. There is more to do that can be done. Strive to be a good friend. an honest critic. Give heartfelt encouragement and minister to him. Remind him to care for his health, to rest when possible, to enjoy jazz and art, family and friends, with regularity. Support him. Third, pray for Stephen. Pray for him. Pray for him with him, and pray for him from behind his back. We contend not with material challenges, but also with powers and principalities. Hold him in the light. Ask God to sustain him. For our God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of courage and a sound mind. May the God whom we glorify fill him and guide him. Pray too for Stephen. Finally, hold him accountable to his promises, to the responsibilities he has taken on, to the mission and commitments of CTS, to those who serve with him, and those who serve under his authority, to the huge divide between what he hopes to accomplish and what is possible, and to God, who makes all things possible. Stephen will make mistakes. He will make wrong turns. Give him your patience and forgiveness. Be kinder to him than he may be to himself. While holding him to the standards of conduct worthy of his office, his vocation, and his call. This is the charge I have for you to keep. This is the calling I have for you to embrace. So I charge you. Grace and peace.
Sisters and brothers, it's an honor to be entrusted with responsibility for this particular service. We gather to witness today the inauguration and installation of Reverend Dr. Stephen Ray as the 13th president of the Chicago Theological Seminary. We will proceed with a series of questions to Stephen, to the CTS community, to members of the UCC, and the broader religious community, to representatives of academic institutions, and finally, all those who are gathered here today as we honor Stephen, witness his promises that he will guide his ministry among us and make us covenant together of mutual support in our common mission as he accepts this new role. Stephen, have you prayerfully considered the duties and responsibilities of this ministry? Are you prepared to serve as president of CTS, to pursue its mission, to perpetuate its values, to keep its commitments in the service to churches, to the diverse communities, to the faith, to society at large, and to the end of ever-increasing justice and mercy in God's name and for the glory of God? If so, please say, with God's help.
With God's help.
Come on up here where I can hold you accountable. Do you promise to exercise your ministry diligently and faithfully, balancing your responsibilities to CTS with those to yourself, to your family, to your communities of faith, and to God, so as to foster wholeness in your own life as well as within this school? And do you promise to love those who live and work and contribute to the ongoing legacy of the school that you lead, foster and fund the institution, that CTS may thrive and our future be bright? If so, please say, I do, relying on God's grace.
I do, relying on God's grace.
Dr. A, Do you promise to lead CTS in the fulfillment of its mission of preparing the next generation of leaders who transform our society and world by living out our commitments to heal divisions and foster hope? And do you promise to facilitate and to support research and teaching that both honors our inheritance of scripture and tradition and breaks new ground and opens new visions and activism that forges new futures and empowers the outcast, the downtrodden, and the poor, while encouraging our bold confrontation of injustice and alienation and our faithful participation in the promised divine reign of justice and mercy? If so, please say, I do, relying on God's grace.
I do, relying on God's grace.
Dr. Ray, do you promise to lead CTS in a manner consonant with our commitments to justice and equitable relations, to listen deeply to our diverse constituencies, and to accept support, critique, and praise as they are offered in the spirit of humility, humor, patience, and grace? If so, please say, I do, relying on God's grace.
I do, relying on God's grace.
Dr. Ray, Stephen, as a sign of your office and a symbol of your vocation as president of CTS, the Board of Trustees and the CTS community as a whole offer you this medallion. Embossed with the CTS seal, may it be a sign to all you meet that there is a place where questioning, teaching, transformation happens. May it be the occasion to tell the story and make new friends who all understand our mission, the CTS mission. And may it be a reminder to all of us of the covenant we make this day to support you, to follow your leadership, to pursue you on our common mission. And as you receive it, we will now sing.
With the trustees, faculty, staff, students, alumnae, alumni of CTS, please stand. Sisters and brothers, you who work and study and hold office at CTS, do you accept Stephen as your president, his leadership, his gifts, and his limits? If so, please say, we do. Do you promise to support him in his new role, offering him your wisdom and counsel, your hope in times of uncertainty, your forgiveness, in times of conflict, your praise in times of celebration? If so, please say, we do relying on God's grace. Do you promise to fulfill your responsibilities to CTS, to pray for Stephen that he might fulfill his, and to continue your support, material, personal, and spiritual, of CTS and its mission and vision? If so, please say, we do relying on God's grace.
As one of our own, the Chicago Metropolitan Association of the Illinois Conference of the United Church of Christ happily affirms the ministry of the Reverend Dr. Stephen Ray. And I, along with colleagues from the Illinois Conference and the National Church, am honored to serve as a representative to make a public covenant with Stephen and with the Chicago Theological Seminary as we commit to the common mission of the United Church of Christ and the Ecumenical Church. As the Chicago Theological Seminary, with the guidance of the Spirit, has called Stephen Ray to the office of president, I ask you, Stephen, are you willing to covenant with both the members of the CTS community and with the CMA to serve as president and as a member of this association with faithfulness and diligence? If so, please answer, I do, relying on God's grace.
I do, relying on God's grace.
Would members of the United Church of Christ and its churches please stand? Dear siblings in Christ, you who represent the denomination and its churches that founded and remain in special relationship to Chicago Theological Seminary, do you acknowledge Stephen as president of CTS with both his gifts and his limits? If so, please say, we do. Do you promise to support him in his new role, offering him your wisdom and counsel, your hope in times of uncertainty, your forgiveness in times of conflict, your praise in times of celebration? If so, please say, we do, relying on God's grace. Do you promise to pray for Stephen, that he might fulfill his responsibilities and to continue your support, material, personal, and spiritual, of Chicago Theological Seminary, of the Chicago Metro Association, the Illinois Conference, and the wider church? If so, please say, we do, relying on God's grace.
Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Holy One of blessing, source of hope and strength, pour out your blessing upon those gathered here, upon Stephen, upon Chicago Theological Seminary, upon the United Church of Christ and its churches, upon all people of faith. Confirm and sustain us in this covenant. Empower us to fulfill your mission, to share the good news that love is alive and will endure and will flourish, and that the face of the earth will be renewed
And let all God's people say, amen. Let us sing together.
Representatives of other Christian denominations, as well as our brothers and sisters who are Jewish or Muslim or belong to another faith tradition, and all individuals who consider themselves persons of faith outside of the UCC, please stand. Sisters and brothers, you who represent the many communities of faith in Chicago, across the nation, and throughout the world, with which the United Church of Christ and its members seek to live in peace and cooperation, do you acknowledge Stephen as president of CTS with both his gifts and his limits? If so, please say we do. Do you promise to support him in his new role, offering him your wisdom and counsel, your hope in times of uncertainty, your forgiveness in times of conflict, your praise in times of celebration? If so, please say, we do, relying on God's grace. Do you promise to pray for Stephen, that he might fulfill his responsibilities and to continue your support, material, personal, and spiritual, of CTS and its mission and vision? If so, please say we do, relying on God's grace.
Would members of the Academy please stand? Sisters and brothers, you are colleagues in the study of religion and the forging of new theologies and fresh interpretations of Holy Writ and the construction of new ethical frameworks. Do you acknowledge Stephen as president of CTS with both his gifts and his limits? If so, please say, we do. Do you promise to support him in his new role, offering him your wisdom and counsel, your hope in times of uncertainty, your forgiveness in times of conflict, your praise in times of celebration? If so, please say, we do, relying on God's grace. Do you promise to pray for Stephen, that he might fulfill his responsibilities and to continue your support, material, personal, and spiritual, of CTS and its mission and vision? If so, please say, we do, relying on God's grace.
Questions of acceptance and support to all who are present this day. Sisters and brothers, we have had the honor of witnessing Stephen promise to fulfill, with God's help, the duties of the office of President of Chicago Theological Seminary. His ministry of leadership, of identifying and accumulating the resources needed for CTS to pursue its mission in uncertain times, of nurturing healthy and wholesome relationships across the institution, that all who work and study here may thrive. Will you join me in thanking God for Stephen, for all the parties to this covenant of mutual support, for CTS and its mission, and for the promise that God will guide us, will order our steps? If so, please shout, thanks be to God. Will you join me in praise of God for sustaining CTS for 163 years, for the gift of a leader sober in judgment and joyful in spirit, for the mission of developing leaders who contribute the increase of justice and mercy and whom this weary world sorely needs? If so, please shout, praise God. Praise God's holy name.
Praise God. Praise God's holy name.
Will you join me in declaring the goodness of the Holy One who has brought us all this far on the way and surely will not leave us, who will accompany Stephen on happy days and in difficult times, who will lead us all on towards that great day when all things shall be well and all manner of things shall be well. Won't you join me as we say, God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. And so we sing.
Whereby the church of every age recognizes God's call to ministry in the lives of faithful women and men and asks the Holy Spirit to confer on them the necessary gifts. I would like to invite those behind me to come down. I would invite Stephen's family to come forward. I would invite all who are close to come forward and lay hands on Stephen as we pray. And I would invite the congregation to stand, and I would invite the congregation to reach out as we offer our prayers.
You should have your hand on his head.
Are we ready? Let us pray. O Holy One, in wisdom you govern all things, and from the beginning you have equipped faithful people to work with you to care for your creation and all therein. Now bless and sanctify your servant, Stephen Ray, whom we, in your name and in obedience to your will, by prayer and with the laying on of hands, install as president of Chicago Theological Seminary, to create a sacred learning community that educates religious leaders, scholars, and activists for public ministries dedicated to the increase of justice and mercy in all your creation. Bestow on Stephen the power of your Holy Spirit, confirming what we do. Empower him to speak with truth and courage, and to act with integrity and boldness. With gratitude for your presence in our lives and in the work of the seminary, we seek your strength in our times of trouble and pray that our words and work bless you now and always. In your holy name, the people together proclaim, Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ and on behalf of all parties to this sacred covenant, CTS and its Board of Trustees, faculty, staff, students, alumni, alumnae, and supporters, the UCC and its churches, the broader faith community, and the community of scholars, I declare you, Reverend Dr. Stephen Ray Jr., duly inaugurated and installed as president of Chicago Theological Seminary. Blessed be the name of God on whom we rely to remain faithful and to these covenant promises. God bless.
Thank you. Thank you from the depths of my heart. Thank you from the depths of my soul. Thank you for this opportunity to walk with you on this path that God has called each of us in building a new world, making a new future. Now, some might wonder why it is that I did not give an inaugural address that laid out a grand vision for what it is that I want to do as the president of Chicago Theological Seminary. There may be some who wonder why it is that I did not create a manifesto that I can share with each and every one of you. But I thought it better that you got a sense of who it was that is leading Chicago Theological Seminary. This has been a journey so that you can get a sense of the things that have made me. I am, as we call at this particular address, a proud Trinitarian, which means that I am unashamedly Black and unapologetically Christian. But it's precisely because I claim those in all of their fullness that God opens my heart to the world, and that God allows me not to create or lead an institution whose doorways are small and whose hands are too short to reach across the aisle of belief, to ask that sisters and brothers of every faith, even if it's just faith in one another, might be able to find a home here. I thought it important that you be able to see and understand the things that enliven my heart. Because many of you know, but most of you don't, that I am just a lifelong UCC-er, and I consider myself a New England Congregationalist. And from the time I've been 13 years old, I said, one day I'm going to be able to sing for all the saints as we march down the aisle. And so when this day came along, I said, this is going to be the day. But I hope that you all noticed that I name our saints. I hope you noticed the pictures of those who were the warriors for our faith, those who fought for our future so that we might have a world that we might have place in, because to me, they are the saints who enliven us and who give us strength. I would be remiss, and I could not imagine this day if I did not give thanks to a woman who has... made me everything that I am. My mother is not with us today because of her health, but I would not be here were it not for Edna Jewel Nixon Gray. I lift her name in this place because were it not for her, this day would not be. I ask your prayers for her health. I ask your prayers that God would continue to wrap her in God's arms of mercy. I also would not be here were it not for the love of a good woman over many years. She is the one who has taught me grace, and she's the one who's taught me to fear arrogance and to always claim humility. She is the one who's taught me to be strong in the midst of storms, the one who has held me up when I have fallen weak. Susan Mildred Paris Ray, I would not be were it not for you. And then my girls, Kiara and Yvette. I've known Yvette since she was 45 minutes old, and I've been her godfather for many, many years. And it has been one of my greatest joys that you have claimed me and that you have loved me. And to Kiara, I thank you for being the source of joy in my life and the source of encouragement. I would like to lift up a special thanks to all of you who have helped to bring me to this place, but there are just one or two people that I want to say thank you to. When I was a seminarian and I was in my second year of seminary and I foolishly went up to New Hampshire in November and all I had was a canvas coat. Now, if you've been to New Hampshire in November, you know a canvas coat is a fool's journey. But there I met who has been a life-changing mentor for me, who has every step of this journey guided me, strengthened me, and given me hope and vision. And that is Dr. David Greenhall. So David, I'm going to ask you to please stand. I would not be here were it not for you. And I asked David to stand especially because he was the one who always never let me be comfortable where I was at, because he would always ask, okay, so what next? I would also like my family to please stand. I have family who has traveled all the way from North Carolina, my Aunt Mildred, my Uncle David, my cousin Cynthia, and cousin Cousin Manley, please stand up. So I'd like to thank them. My cousin Lonnie Manley, I'm sorry, Lonnie, you know, you have those over 50 moments. You remember somebody's name until you look right in their face. And I would also like to thank the greatest set of in-laws that anyone can have, that I sometimes forget that they're in-laws. My mother-in-law, Joan Paris. Stand up, Mom. My sisters, Laura and Wendy. Joseph Masseri and my beloved niece and my beloved nephew. So I thank each and every one of you because, once again, you all are a part of who I am. So I began this with "For All the Saints," because that is where I come from. I come from the tradition of the United Church of Christ, unashamedly, having been shaped by the ways of the New England Congregationalists, the people who made as a central part of their faith the fight against slavery. They are who what made me. As we leave, I hope for our song to inspire you and for our song to lift you. So once again, I thank you each for being here, and I hope that the experience of being with one another will have been a powerful, powerful experience of what it is that you have created in me and the road that I will invite you to go down on. So I thank you, my friends. I thank you. I thank you.
Well, beloved community, it's time for us to part from this great celebration. Let's give Dr. Ray a hand for his presence. And although we're leaving this great sanctuary and this great celebration, know that we're not leaving God's presence, nor has he promised to ever leave us. Let us look to the Lord to be dismissed. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word, and whatever you do in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. And the people of God said, amen, amen, and amen again.
Melody, so I've tried to put in words how I feel.